Welcome to Show Studio. It's a haphazard start to the panel. We're talking about London, and it's our roundup panel discussing spring, summer 17. There's so much to talk about this season. We did our New York one this morning, and it feels like it's a season almost where there's more discussion around the systems and the ways of showing and the business side than there is about the clothes. It was a particularly bizarre season, particularly in London, I guess because of Burberry being the kind of pioneers of the see now, buy now thing, because it meant that people were showing different seasons, and it was very hard to get this sense of a kind of a mood or a consistent idea. But then obviously London's great as well because it is a city that kind of lends itself to lots of different perspectives and lots of different ideas, lots of great young designers. But before we kind of dive in to our discussions, I'll let my amazing set of panellists introduce themselves, starting with you, Danielle.
Hi, I'm Danielle Radojcin. I'm the editor-at-large at ASOS. And I do things like podcasts and content for social media, especially around things like Fashion Week.
Very good broadcaster as well, so you're going to put me to the test.
Hi, I'm Mimma Viglezio. I'm a creative consultant and the editor of Lula magazine.
Hi, I'm Rebecca Gonsalves, and I'm a freelance fashion writer.
Hi, I'm Sasha Wilkins. I'm the founder and editor of libertylondongirl.com and a fashion writer and broadcaster.
Hi, I'm Masha Mombelli. I'm a freelance stylist.
Nice and easy. I want to start, because we've got you here, Sasha, I want to start by talking about one of the, you know, I mentioned at the start that a lot of the discussion this season was about kind of the systems and the communication that goes on around fashion. And this, we talked about it this morning on New York, but I want to get everyone's opinion, this Vogue blogger gate, which I think actually brings to like bigger issues in fashion at the moment, old systems versus new systems, old ways of doing things versus new ways of doing things, communication, digital agitation, which was, I think, the kind of root of that. Just, I know you wrote the piece for The Guardian, but tell me, what was your take on that, and why did it come to a head this season? Do you think it's because there's so much agitation already?
I mean, it has been bananas.
Yeah.
And I suppose because I'm one of the very few people out there who was relatively senior, for people who don't know, I used to be executive fashion editor at the Wall Street Journal, and then obviously I've been blogging for 10 years, so I have a perspective on both sides, which there aren't that many people, I think, who gave up quite a long time ago a fairly senior fashion job to go and blog, and blogging when I hadn't ever seen another blog, so I didn't do it to make money or get people to admire my lovely sleeves or anything. I just did it because I wanted a place
nice
to talk. But then The Guardian rang up and said, would I like to write for their op-ed page about this, not the fashion column,
yeah,
which I thought was interesting, but they felt it was enough of the story to go in the opinion section of the paper.
Yeah.
And the story just ran and ran. By the time I was sitting on the World Service with Lisa Armstrong, I was starting to wonder why the 25 million people globally are really going to be interested in this spat between American Vogue and these global bloggers. But I think you're right. What it really points to is the fact that the systems are changing. And the things that Sally Singer et al. Said in American Vogue, I think a lot of people who go to the shows sympathize with hugely. The circus that it's become, the pointy elbows, the people dressed in slightly bizarre outfits that may not necessarily have anything really to do with fashion, and an awful lot to do with getting your picture taken. But those things have really ever been thus.
Yeah.
They've just, people got their foot on the gas pedal a little bit more.
Yeah.
But it's when they start essentially being vituperative about people in the digital space, telling them to get different jobs, telling the brands they should be embarrassed for working with bloggers. These things don't make any sense because there is no difference between a brand paying a sports star to wear an outfit to be photographed for Vogue and a brand paying a digital influencer to wear an outfit to be photographed at the shows, and that picture will run in Vogue. There's absolutely no differentiation between those two things.
I think it's worth pointing out here as well that the original, I listened to that original podcast, and it actually appeared on, I think, Leandra Medine's podcast, Oh Boy, for Manapella.
Yeah.
It wasn't even on Vogue. And Sally, originally, when she talked about that, she was actually being quite supportive of street style people.
Yeah.
She wasn't slagging them off, and then it kind of spiraled into the story, and I felt like it was just being picked up by the fashion press to create some kind of talking point, because it was actually quite a benign fashion week.
I didn't find it benign in the slightest. I found it offensive.
I agree.
Did you?
I think it was, there was definitely, it did start to feel offensive once Sarah Moa picked it up, and I think, I can't remember her name, but Sally is a deputy at Vogue online in the US, But certainly Sally's original comments weren't at all, I felt like they had been taken out of context.
Yeah.
She did say this is heralding the death of style. It was an unfortunate phrase.
She did. Mm. She also said, though, that she does really enjoy certain aspects of street style. She sort of qualified it in the original, in its original context.
Yeah.
I mean, my Facebook
for a magazine that put Kim Kardashian on the cover, so.
Yeah,
if I may say,
or Kendall Jenner in September. Sad,
we talked about this morning, but what makes me sad is, you know, you were saying being on the World Service, it was a shame in a way because the whole intention, I'm sure, of those women was to protect fashion in some way. You know, they didn't want fashion to be denigrated or in any way seen as something that is facile or silly. But for the rest of the media, it's the perfect story about fashion. It's women being rude to each other. Yeah.
And it's the ammunition that those people want to look down on fashion as an industry.
I did find it strange as well, the piece in The Guardian, when I read it anyway. I know these things always change when you're looking at things digital media, but the photo they used to illustrate a fashion blogger was Susie Bubble. And I think she's actually been a fashion journalist and kind of she's part of the establishment. Yeah. Yeah. She was,
but exactly,
for a
I think
time.
That
she's
was
not really what you'd call a blogger.
A blogger, yeah.
That was the problem, and you pointed it out. I think it got a little bit out of. I think the intention was to criticize what Susie Menkes did 2 years ago, the carnival that happens outside shows that gets nothing to do with fashion, with professional, etc. And then they talked about the bloggers like Susie Bubble or the others that are now professional in every sense of the word.
The Guardian ran three pieces in the end.
Yeah, they ran a
and
lot.
And I don't
yeah.
really understand why people like David Mitchell are writing essays about this, or Giles Corran in the Times. Yeah. And Giles Corran's piece in the Times was so horrifically misogynistic and so insanely rude.
I didn't read it.
And so rude about the fashion industry. Yeah. I was absolutely horrified. You know, fashion isn't a load of women having catfights and pulling out each other's hair, which is pretty much his.
That's what
he
said.
Yeah. Words to that effect. Yeah. And it was appalling. I mean, as the British Fashion Council like to say, £20 billion a year industry.
Yeah.
It's, of course, there are going to be
people have arguments. It's the second biggest British employer. So that's what's so funny about these kind of men getting on the high horse about how silly everyone is. It's like a huge
fashion
huge
is bigger
industry.
Than live sporting events, telecommunications and advertising combined in the UK. So I will step up and say, you know what, you can criticize the way the fashion shows are run, but I think we all know they're changing, and I guess we're going to be talking about Burberry and what everybody did with the C now by now. The shows are changing. They are no longer this secret room where 20 newspaper editors are the gatekeepers and throw out pearls of wisdom like Hilary Alexander or Catherine Samuels in the 80s. That doesn't happen anymore. So to get really upset about the shows is almost an irrelevancy because they don't do the same thing anymore.
The shows have changed. They're not even changing. And
I just feel it's just blown out of proportion. It's really an issue that shouldn't be taking so much space.
Yeah.
Because blogger is a publisher. It's just a person who publishes by themselves.
Yeah.
They didn't go to get a job. They founded a job.
Yeah.
And people who go and dress up for shows, actually, they just really like it. And they just spend ages working out outfit, coming there, getting photographed, just because they want to be part of it. It's just as simple as that.
Mm.
And I think just to say, oh, they shouldn't be there, fashion news should be for everybody. Actually, it's the most democratic, one of the most democratic things. Because everybody gets dressed, everybody wears something.
But I also think that what has to be said is that deal with it. Like, there's no way back.
Yeah.
As we all said, you know, this is what happens now. And I don't know if you've seen the TV series called Collections.
Yes.
I was watching an episode, I didn't see the beginning, so I don't know, but an episode last night where there was the fashion show. And the thing that made me laugh the most is that the only four journalists allowed in, they're sitting on a stairs above, and they're allowed to look down from almost hidden because it's for the client and the society lady. And I was thinking, this is quite telling me something, you know. They were like, they were the least important in it. And, you know, the clients was there. And I think, you know, there's this change that maybe these people are worried about.
Or maybe that we're going full circle, that we're actually going back to the client. You know,
there you go. That's more or less what I was trying to say. I don't think so much, but there is, I think, a little bit of fear and holding on to a certain power that it's actually the silly thing.
But then that's obviously part and tied with the see now, buy now thing, because it's taking away the opportunity for the press to be that interpreter that they've seen themselves as. So they, I think, you know, certain members of the press and certain magazines are feeling really threatened for a number of different reasons. Like obviously the fact that so many bloggers are now phenomenally successful and they're competing for all this advertising money at the end of the day, because they, you know, savvy brands know how to spend their money with influencers, not just with those glossy magazines. It's all about, you know, far more than just, you know, an amazing campaign on the back page of Vogue.
One of the things I wish the women from Vogue had addressed, and I suspect that may have been trying to get there but not articulating it, is that there's a lot of appalling criticism done. You know, people who forget that you, if you're reviewing a show, you're reviewing it because it's good, not because you want to wear it. And a lot of people who do blog review shows based on nothing to do with the aesthetics of the clothing or whether they work in the sense of fashion aesthetics. You know, it's an Alex Fury versus, you know, a 22-year-old who wants to wear a Cavalli dress. They operate in different universes. And so that world of sort of pure, true fashion criticism, which then creates trends and creates stories in Vogue, is just disappearing. And I think if you work on American Vogue, you're probably going to find that very weird, coming to terms with the fact that the fashion street agenda is being set by a woman in her 20s who's probably got her tits out because she thinks Kim Kardashian's great.
But they also talk to different people, I think. But those people that you were mentioning, you know, the democracy around it, are becoming so big and so important that I was reading somewhere recently that those bloggers, when they wear something, it sells immediately, instantly.
Danielle Bernstein, from What I Wear, what her blog is called, Who What Wear. I mean, she charges $20,000-$30,000 for an Instagram, and she
but
can
she
sell
sells
it
out.
Exactly. Do you find that with ASOS?
Do I find, with ASOS,
if a blog influencer, mainly on Instagram, wears an ASOS piece, does it sell out?
I mean, I think we have the Seen On Me hashtag, and whenever somebody wears that and we put it on our Instagram account, certainly we see sales go through the roof. Certainly when somebody who, I mean, it's a kind of known tried and true thing, isn't it? If a celebrity or an influencer wears it.
I don't think that's a bad thing. I don't think
it's a bad thing at all. No. I think it's also important to make the distinction between bloggers and Instagram style stars. You know, they're quite different. Some of them are people who write, and of course everybody's entitled to an opinion about fashion, and but then they're the other ones who are paid to wear the clothes, and that's quite a strong distinction. They don't necessarily write, and they're not opinion formers.
I just want to say one thing, is that I think technology changing how everybody reacting to things, because I think with Instagram and Facebook, actually people are lazy to read. People just want to look at picture, and they're actually lazy to
Well, Facebook
to,
is now the biggest source of sort of news and click-throughs than Google is, which means most people are getting their news and information through scrolling through Facebook and seeing a picture or video that sparks their
And they're
interest.
Being fed it as well, they're not actively searching it. That's, I think, the distinction that's important.
So I think it's all of us contributing to that when we look at the news, like politics through Facebook. I think then we complain that it's people don't want intelligent
content. It is that thing of like the tides are turning, stop the tides, you know, it's just...
I would like to say that the most successful story on my website last year was a 1500 word essay with no pictures in it.
That's interesting.
I agree. I mean, there's still a hunger for reading interesting stuff. You know, it's not probably the immediate thing that we all do in the morning, but people still
that's
read.
That's what gets me a bit with this. Is I think there are some fashion publications or magazines that do amazing written content, employ absolutely fantastic journalists. But a lot of the snobbery that does come, and, you know, American Vogue does have brilliant writers and does do pieces that are very well written and well researched and lovely, but there's a lot of magazine journalism that is incredibly poor, particularly in the context of fashion, and that's also what slightly bothers me as well, this idea that somehow bloggers or people who self-publish are somehow lesser or less intelligent, less well researched, when, you know, if every fashion magazine was operating sort of with the editorial policy of the New Yorker, I'd be like, you know, absolutely fine.
But they're not.
So, and I think that's what's a little bit slippery about all of this as well, is it's like that world of magazine journalism is cloudy and you know, complex and fed by
brands and
money as well. So it's all kind of, you know, who's
Who's
accusing who?
It's very easy
honest.
To forget. I mean, even when I worked at Condé Nast, sometimes an editorial you forget. This magazine doesn't exist to service our creative needs. This magazine exists to make money for the new houses.
Yeah.
But it's very easy to forget that when you're producing a shoot or commissioning a photographer or writing great copy, that actually you're just producing stuff for the vehicle that exists to make cash.
Yeah.
There is no other reason for you to be in that room other than to provide facing pages for ads.
Yeah.
And so, that's one of the reasons why I got my knickers in a twist and agreed to write the Guardian piece, because I felt the hypocrisy was so staggering.
Yeah.
And I just couldn't bear people talk about this anymore.
But also it's the hypocrisy of that website is absolutely chock full of street style images from every city of the same people, of staffers who have made their own little personalities out of what they wear. They have their uniforms, we follow them, we get fed videos of them, how they dress for Fashion Week in their wardrobe, you know.
I interviewed Glenda Bailey in the summer of 2012, I think, for a digital publication I was editing. And I mentioned to her that I'd sat next to one of her ex-market editors who'd just been promoted. And the first thing she said to me, this is 4 years ago, was, she's amazing. She gets photographed all the time. She's so great for Harper's. She's got this great personal street style brand.
Yeah.
And she'd just been promoted pretty much because of her public profile.
Yeah,
nothing to do with how great she was as a market editor.
Yeah, no, definitely. And it is this weird... But I think bringing it back to London Fashion Week, it is this weird climate of agitation, I think, because of things like Burberry and these mega brands changing the system. And that was, you know, really, really prevalent at London Fashion Week, obviously, because of the Burberry shift. But what do we think about this thing now, by now? What do you think about it, Danielle, being there? Because it's interesting, everyone's agitating about what the high street response will be. What's your take on it all?
Well, first of all, I think it's really exciting and great. And I was looking at the website today, and there is something incredibly tantalising about being able to go onto the website and see stuff that I looked at a couple of weeks ago, and then I can actually buy that jacket. And I do think that we live in a culture now where we expect to have things instantly, and it does feel all out of sync to be able to see pictures of a runway show and then you can't wear them for another 6 months. And so I thought that was really exciting. And to your point about the high street thing, I mean, I think it is, you know, I think that, I mean, obviously there's a bit of sensitivity because I know I work for ASOS, but I do, you know, compared to other brands, you know, ASOS doesn't copy these trends in the way that other brands might do. And I think it's really important for designer brands to be able to take back some of that power and to be able to, and then to kind of sidestep plagiarism. So
definitely.
I think it's actually it's a really great thing.
Yeah, I interviewed Sibling not long ago. It's on SHOWstudio in the In Fashion series that we do, and they talked about that. They said they got to a point where they felt like people thought their job was just to be idea generators for the rest of kind of the creative or the fashion industry, and they were like, that has absolutely nothing to do with what we do. They were like, when we put out a collection, it's not to try and, you know, spark people's imaginations, it's to sell our clothes. And I do think that taking back of power is interesting.
If you think, like, you know, in the 60s when Wallace were buying sketches from Chanel, licensing them, and then making suits. My mother has all these original Wallace suits, which are made from Chanel toile. And I love that idea, but the world has changed. And that 1960s things, you know, where the Americans were licensing French couture toile to produce their own lines. I mean, that's how everyone understood how the fashion shows worked. And we've contracted to such a small space now.
Yeah.
I think it's fantastic that brands do... this by now, because it stops the copying. If we all have to take smartphones into the shows, then we're basically sending our pictures to a billion copyists in China.
Yeah.
Thank God for the small designers. I think this is a really good way to go. I was speaking to somebody last week who said, it's to Kate Spade. If you look at a big American brand, sorry, I know we're talking about a fashion week, they only showed their spring summer in New York September past to long lead. They're going to do a big show in February for short lead for See Now Buy Now, because they think they want to keep a very, very close tight for their future, so no one can see it, no one can talk about it. It's only for long leads.
Yeah.
And I wonder if that is the way we're going to go now, where We have these shows which are only for long lead and for critics, and then they'll have the circus for everyone else.
Exactly. My problem, big brands, yes. My problem, if I may, it's absolutely that. I mean, if you're Burberry, you can do it.
Yeah.
You can afford to produce at risk without having sold. You can afford to invite hundreds of buyers and produce for them. I mean, you can afford many things. And when Christopher Bailey was, you know, a little bit harassed by Tim Blank saying, but your creativity will be managed by buyers, he said rightly, I'm not stupid, I know what I'm doing, and it's fine. But if you're not that size, you can't do it. Mm. And again, you know, it's going to be the big houses, the rich one that can do everything, change the system, and then it will kill.
Well, seasonality,
the small designers again.
Seasonality has already pretty much disappeared, hasn't it?
Yeah, but that's not a problem.
But so that's why I think when we're looking at the cycle of shows, how it's going to change.
I don't understand how it actually works now. Do they just kind of make a guess about how many pieces someone's going to want to buy?
No, so Burberry, they previewed with...
They preview with buyers.
And also some press, it was embargoed, but it was previewed.
I have been invited to Topshop embargoed 6 months ago to see what they just showed.
How do they then decide how much of a piece to produce?
Well, they guess for their own website. There's an element of guessing.
It's all about trend prediction. I think it's... finally, these brands acknowledging that all the power at the moment is within trend prediction companies.
Yeah.
But also, if every buyer wants this, they know that even in their website, this will sell. Mm. Because Mr. Bergdorf and Barney's, and they know what's going to sell, and it's not going to be that different from their boutiques or their website. So, yeah, I know that trend forecast is important, but when you can invite hundreds of buyers, you've got your merchandise produced easily.
I suppose in a weird way, allowing designers to sort of take it back to that old-fashioned realm where...
Definitely.
Because when I interviewed Alex Shulman at Fashion Week, the podcast that I was doing at ASOS, she was saying how that she'd seen all the by now collections before they'd been on the runway. So it's almost like going back.
It is quite old.
In a weird way.
She has the power to see before, exactly.
Yeah. And what do we think of the Burberry show?
I think it was really amazing.
Did you like it?
Yes, I liked it. I think it's... I want to say what I felt. For me, it was really amazing that they went to English culture, you know?
Yeah.
Orlando, wasn't it?
Yes.
Virginia Woolf.
Virginia Woolf. It's really one of a big, magnificent events in English literature.
Yeah.
And it's very
It's a rich brand. And because before... when they employed Beckham's son to take pictures. Actually, I had a really negative opinion about the brand.
Yeah.
I felt like it's finished. Yeah. It's so shit.
Yeah.
But you know, when I saw that, I thought, wow, actually, it's a very beautiful product. It's very beautiful idea
really
to base
it seems
the
more
show.
More intelligent, doesn't it?
Yes, exactly. It's intelligent. You want intelligent design from a brand like Burberry.
And
you know,
it's very rich and very luxurious, which I seem to have missed recently.
I think you're right. Yeah. It does feel British. And actually, it had something where normally, I always think with a Burberry collection, you think, well, you know, in 6 months' time, you've got 6 months to think, yeah, I really want that metallic trench coat or whatever. But this, because I thought that it was going to be so much more flashy and like grabby because it was seen now by now.
Yeah.
I thought it would be something really obvious, but I don't think it was. I think it was actually quite considered and restrained and focused on.
And
craft
far more complex
and luxury.
Than you would expect.
Exactly, layered. It was so layered, but not in a we're going to layer up all the product we possibly can and make you buy it all.
It was a really lovely narrative, wasn't it?
We did do a Burberry panel, so I don't want to sound like a kind of breaking record, but I slightly took a shit. Like the Orlando thing, I get it, Britishness, blah, 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 blah. But like, I do slightly have problems with brands jumping on this kind of gender fluidity, gender freedom.
But he's done
why?
The Bloomsbury collection. But this is
because it's not genuine. I mean,
but it is with Burberry because he's done the Bloomsbury set. He's looked at Charleston before. This is absolutely woven Christopher Bailey's DNA
also
for
the
Burberry.
Their big
seller
is the trench coat. Could you think of anything more tied into masculinity? And they work on it.
But Burberry today isn't like that. I agree. There's so many products in their history that are so rooted in androgyny, but Burberry, like, it's girls in little lace dresses and men in suits. If you look at the campaigns, they're so heteronormative. It's always like a kind of little pouting girl with a man in a suit.
But that's because they sell more in Asia than anywhere else.
I know, but that's what my kind of problem is slightly with it, is I think I don't...
With the brand, you mean? With that brand, not in fashion in general.
Fashion in general, I think when big brands take an issue that is really important to certain... We're talking about it this morning about someone like...
But they need to be involved. They need to reflect the fact that that is one of the biggest talking points, not just in fashion, but
in
social culture. So, you know, they don't exist in a vacuum. They're going to be inspired by those sorts of issues.
And I think, to Rebecca's point, actually, like, when I look at the Burberry show, I looked at it again just recently, I think, you can see, obviously, he's following a trend that, you know, Alessandro Gucci's been doing, which is that kind of eclectic mix. But also, you know, I was at the V&A yesterday looking at their You Say You Want a Revolution show, and actually, I see a lot of that in there with the brocades, and it's almost like the Sgt. Pepper style jackets and stuff. Yeah. So in that way, it does feel culturally relevant, and I think that, to your point, I think that... That feels really
And if you look
great.
At the Adam J.W. Anderson, who had those incredibly romantic shows this season, there is that feeling of historicity, is that a word? But that lovely... But that is a big narrative through this season.
Yeah.
So this show, to me, seems to fit into what London was saying. And it is difficult with their ads, but given the market where their biggest advertising spend is, it's... pretty much inevitable it is going to be heteronormative like that, because that's where they're selling.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not exactly like everyone in London's rushing out to hit themselves in Burberry head to toe, are they?
Yeah. No, I agree. I just, it's a slight kind of sore spot for me. I just think that kind of...
So is it an appropriation, you think?
I just think, I think this was slightly a season of big brands making missteps when it came to appropriation of different...
Mark Jacobs, hello.
I agree. And I just think it's something that... It concerned. I think it was a season where I thought a lot about the young labels and how they must be feeling, and I thought a lot about authenticity, because so much of this season was to do with sort of spectacle and creating talking points and blah blah blah. And often you do feel like it's a lot about veneers and finishes rather than kind of authentic stuff. And I don't know, it just worried
me
slightly.
But it's always been. I mean, I totally agree with you, but I'm not. In shock, because I don't think it's any different than it's always been like that. I mean, it is a spectacle, and they just produce clothes that are relevant with the style. As you say, they don't live in a vacuum. But then they need to write some paragraphs that usually don't mean much, just to give us. And we're here talking about that. I see what you mean, but it's not very different than usual. Maybe this is a theme that touches you more. I don't know, and that's why.
I love
that. I don't think Burberry does it more than others. I think even less. There are other brands that we're not in London, so we'll discuss them in another panel, but they do it more. I think. I don't know what my co-panelists think.
Nobody came in the defense of cybergrowth hair. And actually, Marc Jacobs, it was a classic cybergrowth hair. I think it would have been better show without that kind of hair, because clothes is very nice, and it's a little bit overstyled.
It did look a little bit like they'd been done Cyber Dog in Camden.
It was a little bit overstyled, I think, But
Should we talk about, you mentioned J.W. Anderson, I would like to talk about the J.W. Anderson show, because I thought it was really beautiful and I really, really liked it, and obviously...
The sleeves.
Sleeves. What's really great about going to a J.W. Anderson show now is he's doing this new thing. He's shown in the same space quite a long time, but for the sake of our viewers who don't go to the show, he's built in these walls, which are kind of part of the set, so it's really intimate. You know, most fashion shows, you're looking around at everyone there, but you can only see the people opposite you, and he kind of sections the space off, and you are sat so close, like, you can see it there. And it was really amazing, because some of the models, you could feel the fabric brushing against you, and they would like wallop you with their back on the way past.
But it feels like a salon show, which I think
it does. And
very much.
There's no front row. Everyone is on the same row, which is such a important thing for people to do, because, you know, it doesn't matter where you're sat. You see the collection fully. Yeah. You see the shoes, the whole look, everything.
Which is great, because, I mean, we've all been sitting second, third, fourth row, and you're like, great, she's fab from the waist up. Christ knows what she's wearing underneath.
Great shoulders.
Well, Ralph started doing that when he made everyone stand. That's like the men's shows. Like, there was, I can't remember how many seasons ago, maybe it was about 5 seasons ago, everyone got their tickets and everyone was like, just your seat number, what's going on? Mm. And then you got to the show and everyone had to stand. Mm. Like everyone was
You were below the show.
It didn't completely start on time.
Because some shows start 40 minutes late.
Yeah. But it was fun because it was actually quite nice because it was like you talk to people and you wander around.
It's like a big party.
Yeah, and his last show was in Pitsy and he had loads of archive stuff out on mannequins around the space. So it almost felt kind of like somewhere between a presentation and a show, and you kind of stood wherever you stood, and it was more like a happening, and that's kind of great. There's something about, I actually think, that row system where it feels quite mundane because you go in, you sit down, you're with the same people. So something like Raph loves to kind of, you know, disrupt and make it
like there's a big hierarchy. Who sits where and everybody's looking.
I think you know, most people, how many people can look at it just online?
Yeah.
And that's how most people are going to see it now. Mm. So I do think they're probably thinking of the full frontal.
It looks a lot better. Mm. Like
But I think what's probably interesting is that he probably thought about the fact that you can, because I did notice that, I only looked at it online, but I did notice how close the audience was listening to.
Mm. Yeah.
And I think it does give it a feeling of slight, almost, it's not claustrophobic, but
it's... And it's always the same, so you're not distracted by, oh, what idea will Carl have this season, you know what I mean? You just know, you more or less know where you will be sitting, and you're there, and as Lou was saying, you're so close to the clothes, you can feel the way they move, you can really do what they're meant to do.
Which is also the only reason to be at a fashion show.
And it does the same, it tries to do the same more or less with Loewe, which, by the way, was my favourite show of the season, but that's for tomorrow, where there's more people and it's bigger, but almost everybody is front row and it's very close. The way it puts those cubes, those chairs, is very close. And there's very few people that are
I think it's also, it suits him as a designer because I think he is someone that likes to do things that are slightly uncomfortable or jarring, both in the collection itself and, you know, it can be everything from the soundtrack to the music, like Michelle.
He's quite a jarring designer anyway.
He likes that, exactly. So that kind of environment, it's not actually particularly, in some ways it is quite uncomfortable. Like you can really see everyone's reactions and it's really close and kind of reminds me, like Nick always talks about, obviously a lot of the McQueen shows, and when McQueen did Voss and it was a mirrored box, and obviously everyone was kind of confronted with their own reflection, and this is much simpler, much less theatrical than that, but it suits his aesthetic because you go there and you feel a little bit uncomfortable, and then the clothes come out and it's not like a crowd pleaser type show in some ways. It's quite difficult. It's a bit like a Prada show in that sense. It's not.
I don't think anyone would ever call J.W. Anderson a crowd pleaser.
But let's just think about, I mean, he's very clever because it's talking about street style as well. I mean, everybody was carrying his cock ring handbag, right?
I know, yeah.
So actually, it's quite canny. So he does have that commercial sensibility, I think.
Yeah, definitely.
You have to when you're at a Brat Wayne. You're working for a brand like Loewe. You have any choice.
He's so good, but though. I think he's amazing.
I think he's actually the most important designer in London at the moment. I don't know. I feel he has really a lot to say, and since he started, it gets more interesting and more interesting. Mm. It's very modern.
Do you not think there's an inherent misogyny in his clothes? I don't get the impression he loves women very much, or the women he's dressing.
Why do you think so?
Because they're uncomfortable and there's an edge to them, and there's just something never quite sits with me about his view of
women.
But
then, you could argue that both ways, though, couldn't you? Because you could say, you know, there's an edge to them, and in a way, maybe that's intended as a celebration, or that they don't have to be kind of mollycoddled by their clothes or made to feel. I hear what you're saying with this because I think the clothes are difficult. But actually, this collection, more than any, was quite elegant. You know, there was a lot of bias cut. A lot of historical shapes, references to kind of throwing away old styles of dress. Like there was this jacket that I really did think was amazing, where it was kind of like half a corset. So it was often this idea of kind of, you know, removing restraints and what have you. I think his clothing is difficult to an extent. I think it's for a particular body shape, perhaps. But I think actually,
90% of designer clothes are not comfortable. That's not why we wear it. Look at shoes.
but look how shoes have changed.
It's not about... another thing I want to say about J.W. Anderson is that it's very important about image making, because I think one of the most important photographers now in London, Jamie Huckersworth, who works with him throughout long time, and the kind of images created, they just bring this aura of like interesting artistic point of view. I think it's very connected. I don't know any other brand in London at the moment who does that well.
Well, he's very clever in that sense of it's actually quite an old-fashioned way of working, in the sense that from a very early stage, he has his stylist, Benjamin Bruno, and he has his photographer, Jamie Hawksworth, and their crew. And actually, that's, if you think, kind of, that is how a lot of the big, big designers operate. You know, Nicolas Cusier,
exactly.
With Marie Amélie, and Raf Simons, Willy van der Peer, and Via Rizzo. It's a way that they work. And I think what he was really clever at doing, and I think it probably comes from his conviction in himself, is even though he was a super young designer, he was like, well, I want a great team. You know, we're going to be the new god. And he assembled that really quickly. Whereas you're right, you know, your Erdems or your Christopher Keynes, you don't think that's their stylist, that's their image maker. And he's been so good at making this crew, this set of people. And then obviously with MM Paris coming in and doing a lot of the work and the Loewe stuff, it's really been kind of elevated. And I think it's really clever. It gives another talking point, and it feels like it makes it even more like a moment in fashion rather than just a designer with a great collection.
I mean, these pictures are beautiful. It underlines his vision much clearer. I mean, if you saw the launch of the perfume, there was nothing outside of his box. And I think that's when you're a great designer. I mean, you have, which I think that's what Phoebe did 10 years ago. You have one vision, you have one idea, and that's, you
and
know,
you
like
it. You articulate it to the nth degree.
And it was, and it was criticized at the beginning because of some controversy. But I think today, I think he's one of the most important designer around, even in London. And when you see what he's done with the means that were given to him by Loewe, it's just mind-blowing. The guy is not even 30, you know,
he's not
so mature.
He's not I think he is over 30 now, isn't
okay.
he? I think
well, he's very young.
Yeah, he's super young, I think he's an image maker, though, isn't he? And that's what, going back to what all of us were talking about before. And it's interesting, I'm sure, designers are much less vocal than journalists and the editors of American Vogue who flag off bloggers. But I'm sure there are a lot of more old-school designers who perhaps find someone like a J.W. Anderson frustrating, because in some ways he's not about the craft and the make. He's not a designer's designer. Like, he's an image maker. He's a curator. He's a creative director. He's all those new things that designers are. And it's very different to a lot of designers where they are about the cut of a dress. They are about getting their hands dirty and a love of...
But he's more than he wants to say, because the Loewe show was also very well made, and there was a lot of craftsmanship behind, and there was a lot to do with the choices of fabrics, how they were put together. So I know he likes to present himself like that, and I think it was also very smart of him not to be, but I think he's more of a designer than he wants to admit.
One thing that I interviewed him about 3 years ago, maybe less, 2 years ago for Bonn, and he was really, really candid in it, and it was great. I think they put it online now, so you can reread it. And I asked him who he thought his peers were, because I said, you know, in London there's like a real crew, like, you know, your Christopher Keynes, your Erdems, your Roxanders, they all support each other. Who are your peers? Because I was like, you've always stood, like, I never, you know, you see Christopher Keynes and Roxanders supporting each other, blah, blah. I was like, you never see him involved in that. He was like, oh, I don't know, like, he was like, I love Ray Kawakubo, I love Mitch Prada, blah, blah. He was like, I won't call them my peers yet. And then kind of, I think it was a bit later on in the interview, he was like, it's too domestic to be in that whole London thing. And he was like, I've always wanted to be bigger than that. And he was like, there are these huge jobs. And he was like, who is there for them? Seriously, who is there? And it was incredibly bold thing to say in a way, because he was basically being like, you guys are being small fish.
Yeah.
Like, be a big fish.
Yeah.
And that's what he's done. You know, he's been like, he had the foresight to be like, no, I'm not going to be like a London cool, I'm going to be like this. And now, he's in that position where he's rumoured to go to Dior, or if Karl Lagerfeld drops off the face of the earth, he'll be rumoured for Chanel. You know, he had that foresight to be like
big.
And it just fact that who is that? Like, and he's
how is Loewe doing commercially outside of the bags?
I don't know. I haven't seen, because, you know, no, but LVMH, they don't separate the brand.
Yeah. It's really hard to find.
I
think they're doing better, but it's just a feeling by talking to it. And also seeing the size of the concessions in...
Yeah.
I was in New York for Fashion Week, and I went to see all the department store. It is, I mean, it's present now.
But it's very accessory heavy.
It's present, getting bigger, right? You know, yeah. It's almost as big as the Raw in America, and we know that the Raw sells a lot. So
yeah.
when you see the size of the concessions in department store, you think it must be selling more than, including ready to wear. I mean, there was so much.
Mm. It's interesting.
What do we think of the other kind of set of London designers that we kind of were mentioning there? So you're kind of your Erdems and your Christopher Kanes, your Roxannes, because it was Christopher Kane's 10 years, so it's an interesting time for him. I love this. I thought it was a really lovely collection. But he's such a, going back to what we're saying about J.W. Anderson, he's such a different designer to a J.W. Anderson, in the sense of he does love the make, and you know, he's not an image maker in that same way.
He's
a more conservative designer in that sense.
But it's like he does have this boundless imagination, because you can sit at his shows and you think it's finished, and then another set comes out, and another set of inspiration. And it's sometimes you think there are six shows in one, because
it just, radius.
Just keeps on coming.
Yeah.
I mean,
it was quite a commercial collection for him. And I mean, obviously the Crocs were the thing that caught everyone's eye.
The Croc. Yeah.
And everyone was commenting on those. And that was great. I think that's such a genius thing to do, because as we at ASOS all know, like, shoes on Instagram perform better than anything else. So that was probably a stroke of genius. But I did think the collection was really commercial. I wonder if that was tied into Brexit and this kind of idea that there might be a little bit of a panic with designers around, or not panic, but maybe thinking about selling their clothes overseas, and maybe that's making them.
Yeah, he's also just launched his e-commerce as well, his own thing. So I imagine there is this kind of, you know, increased focus on that. But also, I think, you know,
pressures from the new majority stakeholders as well.
I think he actually quite enjoys that. Like, I spoke to him recently about this. Like, I think he actually really likes the idea of catering to lots of different girls. Like, he was kind of being quite funny, and he was like, you know, I want them all. I want the fashion girl, but I want them all. But I do think there's that thing of he is making these kind of staple pieces that he brings across from season to season to season, and I actually think he kind of enjoys doing that. And you do see them again and again, and I kind of like that.
I think it was a very beautiful collection this season.
Actually, I just want to ask, what are the staple pieces? What do you think, when you think Christopher Kane, what do you think about?
I always think some kind of interesting knit.
Yeah,
you know, something.
A cardigan.
Yeah, a cardigan.
A pencil skirt.
Yeah.
And more actually, a beautiful look dress. On the right-hand black side, tailoring. Where there's always some skin coming out of a black tailor dress.
Yeah, exactly. Or almost an interesting fastening or something like that.
Don't you think also Prada does pencil skirt and knitted top? Or you can name turn up a design. I'm just curious, because
he doesn't have an it piece, I don't think, that same way that you would.
I see what you mean. Mm. Yeah. Because I would have a real problem in mentioning, you know, like for other designers you can.
Yeah.
But then you can't forget,
you know,
her
them a dress, Nicolas, skinny trousers.
But then I think her them a dress is really reductive, because that's kind of essentially all that he does. But that's,
you don't really go there for
really
a nice
underselling. That's really underselling what he does.
No, but you don't go there for the best tuxedo of your existence.
No, yes, but you go there for like
frock,
the fanciest frock you can find.
Yeah.
No, but it wasn't diminishing for me. I was just giving categories. Yeah. I wasn't being critical.
No, but that's the thing. I think you can really pigeonhole Erdem because of that. And I don't think you can with Christopher Kane.
Yeah. Yeah.
You
think
can.
It's more, no, I don't think you can.
Exactly.
It's more of a wardrobe.
Yeah, we're saying the same thing.
Yeah, I want
sorry.
To know.
I wasn't critical either. It's just... sorry to interrupt. I just... I think this collection is so beautiful. It's so amazing. But there's so... It's very, very heavy styling. It's very heavy styling, and actually I'm not quite sure what is the idea, because there's so many different things.
Well, the whole
and
thing was make do and mend, wasn't it? So I think that clutter, we talked about this already with the Burberry thing, but this cluttered thing is obviously having a big moment in fashion anyway, you know, it is the
in
spirit
London.
Of the time.
In London.
Oh, in London especially, but also it is Alessandro Michele, Gucci, you know, like throw it all on, raid your grandma's closet, blah blah blah. So I think that kind of spirit is definitely in the air. And yeah, this was all that kind of make do and mend, which I guess is probably what you were saying, actually, is how he's probably feeling a bit. Like, you know, I think it's a difficult time to be a designer. It's a difficult time in the world. It's a difficult time, particularly in the UK, in the context in which they were putting together these collections because of Brexit. It's also a really difficult time in the fashion system. So I think that kind of make do and mend thing, it's, you know, that get up and go. But I think that's... I liked that as a message in the collection.
Do you think Crocs came to him, or he went to Crocs? Because they sent out a press release after the show saying it was a collaboration. So it definitely wasn't just...
I think he probably went to Croc.
Well, he said that he went to Croc.
Really?
Yeah. I don't see Croc thinking, waking up one morning and saying, Christopher King, you
curious.
But well, I think if it was PR-led, then that person deserves a very big bonus.
Yeah, he's so good at ugliness, you know, like, yeah. And I think this comes...
It's that perversity. You
know, it is, exactly. That's he has huge admiration for Mrs. Prada,
exactly.
Who does
that's
it
where I can see him being the pupil of Mrs. Prada, because he's the best in London to do that ugly that becomes amazingly beautiful, and that's what we
that's also a trend at the moment as well. You've got Vetmore, you know, Vetmore doing all those collaborations with Levi's.
I have to punch that it was done in a bit different way, because it was done in a conceptual way with Vetmore. Because they did like 15 collaborations and they thought about every garment, who does what best, what you wear, because it's a collective design group.
And gems on.
So it wasn't just like, oh, let's go to Croc for the shoes, because we need the shoes for the show. It was like, let's go to Manolo, because he does the best heels.
I don't think
Christopher Kane was like, oh, we need a shoe collaborator. Who should it be? Croc. Yeah.
Exactly. No, I don't think they say we need shoes,
way
Croc.
Of collaboration. You know?
It was... Yeah. But can I say something about, because you were talking about trends in London, for me it's been a little bit, London it's been very much the season of the women's designer. I was quite impressed by Rotsanda collection, never before. I thought the whole thing, the collection, the show, the colours.
I just think the more fluid she becomes, the better it is.
So good. And Simone, who I always loved, Simone Rocha, was, I think, better than ever.
Yeah.
And now, of course, I wanted to say someone else is escaping me, but I came out, you know, saying, I think this ugly trend is little by little going away, and we're going back to beauty. I was never a fan of the ugly trend.
We're going back to that really strong femininity.
We're going back
really
to beauty.
Like idealized.
The makeup was more beautiful, and it wasn't like make a woman look ugly and dirty because that's cool.
Like Tatum Jones, who opened Fashion Week, they did a beautiful collection. Mm. It was really beautiful, and I was surprised how beautiful it was.
Well, I do think there is this other side to London, though, where while you're seeing things that are more, as you say, kind of beauty, and like the Erdem show, I think, was a lesson in that. It was like breathtakingly beautiful.
But do you think with Erdem, it's because he always has a story in his head? Because he, do you remember that the Nijinsky show when Amit Kirkwood did the laced-up shoes and he did it in a big top, and this time we've got, was it Mistress of Charles I? And sometimes you feel
it
that
like
his
shipwrecks.
His narrative is so strong that it overtakes the clothes.
It's a bit too costumey.
It overtakes it.
I mean, of course, it was very beautiful, but it was like a film.
No, I don't know. I disagree. I thought the pieces looked so light, which is I know that sounds ridiculous, because when you look at them, it's so sort of, they were breathtakingly kind of made, and there's a lot going on. But like, I think it was something in the they just looked so. I think particularly these kind of pieces. I felt like there was a real lightness to it. Like I'm not an Erdem girl in terms of
very light,
but
me too costume.
It's really me.
It doesn't look like you.
I loved it. I thought it was amazing, and I find him really fascinating as a designer. I find his links. I think his references are really interesting and very subtle. He's not a J.W. Anderson where he's going to be talking about, you know, Bloomsbury set and arts and craft and all the time.
You know, the first
but
time
he's got amazing art references.
The first time I met Erdem was on the stands when the shows were at the Natural History Museum. So we're talking early 2000s, maybe. I think it was his first or second, maybe his second collection. He was just on the stands trying to sell a collection. We talked about brocades and the history of fabric. And he knows so much about the history of fashion. It's just innate within the clothes that he makes.
Yeah. But I don't know if they told you, but Daniel Marks, who does his PR, told me the story behind this show. Do you know the story?
About the dress that they found.
The woman that drowned, and this is the wardrobe that he imagined for her if she had gotten to Paris.
Yeah.
So, you know, and the woman, I don't remember, but she was famous. She was.
Well, there's one dress that was in his little visual thing that he gets out, and they refound it last year.
Exactly.
And it had, like, survived.
But then he went, he studied the whole story, and this gentlewoman that was going.
She was a maid, lady in waiting to. Someone whose name I forget, who was like a French royal.
Exactly. Yeah. And she was going back to Paris from New York or vice versa, and she drowned. I mean, the Titanic sort of thing.
Yeah. With all her wardrobe.
And this is the wardrobe that from the dress that they found, Erdem imagined she would have been her wardrobe. Yeah. And I think it's spectacular for an exhibition.
Mm. Oh, no,
that's my problem. Yeah. I mean,
it's also quite sexy, costumey. I think.
It's quite costumey. Yeah.
It's amazing.
As well.
Did you not like it?
I actually liked it more than I usually do.
Yeah.
I find that he can be quite derivative and his copying is too clear and it changes season to season.
So what did you feel that this was too...
McQueen?
Yeah.
Proenza?
Yeah. That's interesting.
Dolce. It was beautiful and very romantic.
Yeah, I don't see McQueen, but I see Proenza and Dolce.
I'm sure there would be so many people who want to wear it.
I think that's the thing, it's a case of question. Yeah,
totally.
You don't go, like, we're saying it's costumey, but I think the woman who goes to Erdo wants, like, the most breathtaking dress. Possible.
And I love seeing him on the red carpet.
Do you think women would wear this?
Thank God, not another bloody fishtail dress.
Yeah.
He dresses intelligent, beautiful women, and it makes a real refreshing change, I think, to see these kinds of clothes on the red carpet.
Mm. I really loved it.
Do you disagree, Mimma?
I mean, I hate saying this because I also like him a lot, and I'm certainly not an Erdem style woman, but I like what he does, and I understand why he's been so successful. I was sitting at this show thinking, why does it have to be so cinematic, so costume design? And it's not diminishing on his talent, but I don't see any relevance to this. It's a little bit...
Well, it was particularly
Downton Abbey
awkward this season because then McQueen did shipwrecks as well, so it was like, okay, everyone shipwrecked.
But also I think the way that he stages it, he does create amazing staging, it's really beautiful, it's really captivating, you feel completely absorbed by it. But then I think the clothes don't necessarily relate that well to reality. So some of these clothes are beautiful and will be inspiration for, I'm sure he'll do a lot of bridal orders. Mm. And, you know, there are things that will be worn on the red carpet. But realistically, I don't really understand who the customer is for this. I understand someone who's like, well, I've got this much money, I want to get an amazing dress, I'm going to go to Erdem's
store. You know what's interesting? They're quite modest, some of these clothes. Mm-hmm. And the moment you start thinking about modest clothing, you're immediately looking towards the UAE, the Middle East. Mm. And these are incredibly ornate, incredibly beautiful, modest looking clothes. I think I can see exactly who's going to be buying.
There's obviously a huge market for it. If you like, there is, it's that Valentino kind of like primness. And I think it's also, it is interesting because for a long time, like him, Erdem, Roxanda, even maybe Mary and Christopher Cove, they kind of all were put in this kind of cocktail dress and they all have gone a very different way now. And like Erdem has gone much more towards the gowns and the raiments and the more costumey side. Whereas Christopher Kane's more kind of punkish and eclectic, Roxanda much more pragmatic, and it's good to see the split between all of them. What did everyone think of the Mary show?
It's interesting, she went back to, she used all those Hellenic references, which you haven't really seen, given her background. She's never really gone down that route before, which I thought was interesting.
I wrote my favourite, my best line that I've ever written in the fashion report. I said, my big fat Greek fashion show. I was really proud of it.
But it's funny because I liked it. I didn't love it as much as last collection, but then I went to the showroom in Paris and the clothes hanging there were fantastic. I absolutely adore them. So I think for me, the problem in this show was the set design. That was becoming too, it was a little bit overwhelming.
It's Instagrammable moments.
Yeah, I know, but it's, and even if I see it there, but then I went to the showroom, I saw the collection, and I think it's one of her strongest to date.
It's interesting how she's evolved so much in terms of her tailoring and the actual construction
incredible.
Of her clothes.
I mean,
it's
incredible.
And in such a short period of time.
Couldn't agree more.
I think the clever thing that she did was like veering away from prints for a while.
Yeah.
Going into kind of texture and silhouette and stuff. So she's kind of managed to cover all bases a bit now.
Is Alex still consulting with her?
I guess so. They're very good friends. I presume so, yeah.
I think she's doing a great job. I put her into the... and I was a non-believer at the beginning. I told her, so I'm not saying anything. You know, when she started...
You didn't want a lampshade with fringing on it.
Unbeliever meaning all the sprints, and I was like, where's the tailoring? Where's the fashion? And now, I think she's really one of the good designers around.
Well, she just listens to her. Like, I'm
she's
obsessed
very good.
With how, like, she's always in a different country. She's always
and
with her
look
clients.
At people like Ikram, Neiman Marcus in Dallas.
Yeah.
They have always bought Mary Kay because there is that woman out there who wants
an extraordinary and different frock that's also quite flattering.
Yeah.
And I've seen women in Singapore wearing full Mary Kay show looks, you know, the 12 yeah. grand embroidered yeah. ones yeah. that yeah. no one's ever supposed to wear, really, yeah. like a McQueen show look. I mean, yeah. no one like goes out to Sainsbury's wearing a McQueen show look.
Yeah.
And I've seen women in Singapore wearing a show look.
Hint Swarovski.
Yeah. I mean, it's utterly extraordinary because, and they don't care about dropping 12 grand because yeah. they think that's what a frock costs, yeah. lucky them.
Because they can.
But isn't mm. it, I think it's amazing that Mary found that audience almost from her first collection.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
to sell to in America to the amount that she yeah. did by her, I think her third season was spectacular.
Yeah, she's got such yeah.
I don't think she's had nearly enough press.
I agree. She's very, very good. And she's
I
a
think
lovely
she
person.
Just doesn't,
she is, isn't she?
She's
I
lovely.
I think she doesn't care. She's not in that London. I think, you know, with the press thing, I kind of agree with you, but then I think it's just... That's not her world. Her world is the women that wear these clothes from all these different territories.
And it's super international.
It's like, I think it's just a different kind of brand in that sense.
I remember visiting her studio maybe 4 or 5 years ago and looking at all the rails with all the different boutiques, the stuff that was waiting to go out from... It's just that this is extraordinary. Mm. You've barely been going a couple of years and you're yeah. already sending your clothes around the
yeah.
world.
Mm.
She
yeah.
took off phenomenally.
It was yeah. crazy.
What do we think about all the kind of younger designers? Because it's interesting we're talking about this ladylike thing, because I feel like one of the biggest things that came out of London this season, particularly people like Fashionese, and obviously you've got your Molly Goddards and what have you. Ryan Lowe, particularly, Faustine. But there's this real kind of, it's a different kind of eclecticism to what we were talking about with your Christopher Kane, and it's this kind of girlishness in this like little bit like Riot Girl. It's quite tough. It's ugly in its own way, and it's, I would, like, you work with, the whenever I come see you at ASOS, you've got, like, the coolest girls there. They're all, like, really, like, these young, cool, yeah. amazing girls. I feel really old and weird.
They are very cool.
But they're really into this kind of sensibility,
yeah.
aren't they?
Yeah. I mean, I think, you know, I'd go back again to the kind of Instagrammable moment that you mentioned, and definitely there is an element of that. It's like, how can you stand out in the curated feed? But you know, I do think there are some really, really talented young designers, especially young women, you know, yeah. like in my office, the cool girls, they're all, you know, obsessed with Claire Pepiat, obsessed with Ashley Williams, they all love Molly Goddard. So I think there is, yes, there's the kind of thing about standing out, but then there, I don't know, there's some sort of desire to be different to what's on the main runway. And I think it yeah. is just that they want to set themselves apart by being young and cool, and that's yeah. I guess Fashionista sort of epitomizes that.
Well, there's so much like youth does youth, like youth mm. aware of the power of youth this season. I really felt particularly Fashionista and Molly as well. It is like Molly with the rave stuff that she did.
Yeah.
And Simone needs to do this with her. Less so, now Simone's become a mother, she's like a different stage of life now. But Simone, a lot of her early collections were like, you know, teenagers kissing, all of that kind of, and that is something that's so seductive in fashion. But I thought that particularly with the Fashionista show, it was just like, look at us, we're young. So
don't you think that's really interesting? Yeah. The difference between the kind of polish, if you think of like Roxanda's polish mm. and Mary Catherine Zoo. Maybe that is the main way, one of the ways that young and older
designers
are kind of
right. Graduation. For me, the problem with Fashionista this year, not the whole of it, but there was some that was really bad quality clothing mm. and it's I don't agree, you know. It has to be, oh, we're cool again, you know, we're cool if it's badly made and it's still fashion and it's still, you're selling in Fashion Week or whatever.
Yeah.
So whilst when you go to a Faustine Steinmetz or Molly Goddard, yeah. it's much more curated. That's for me it's better, you know, mm. and I love this difference between really young or people like me that you know, it's right, it's correct that it exists. Fashionista this year was less
you know what's interesting?
Enthusiastic.
It's all yeah. quite pretty and colourful and lovely. I mean, anyone who sat through, I know, Jens Laversen's show or Hamish Morrow when he was doing his mountaineering ropes late 90s, which was always, you know, the young British designers were always incredibly depressing, very architectural, and you had to really think yeah. when you looked at their clothes.
I think that's post-medium Kirchhoff.
I mean,
and Sophia Webster, and Sophia Webster, and Bubblegum, and Instagram, and Susie Lau.
It's this reclaiming of girlishness.
It's extraordinary.
Somehow liberating.
It's so much
more fun. In my office, it was always the thing of the young girls. They were all upset. They just don't want to look like Celine. It's like whatever. Yeah. That's the fate worse than death, to look
really?
Like a minimalist.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
No, it's exactly the point I wanted to make because
excuse me.
I think
we're all dead.
I think there's something unexplored about Madame Couture brand that we like, there's still this big feeling to go there among designers. And you can see this girlishness done in a quite variety of way, and it's actually quite a lot of it. Mm. From like Ryan Law, which is very kooky and really, really cute.
And he's more the French, like he's like Charles and Stace and Sonia Rica. Yes. It's different kind of, you know.
Much prettier, also, I think.
And then Molly Goddard, which is a kind of very interesting type of dress, actually. Yeah. It's a very kind of like aristocratic girl in a rave.
Yeah,
I absolutely love what she does.
It's like party dresses, isn't
it? Yes, it's
a
party
different way to like a Roxanne or a Christopher Kane party dress. But it's,
but so it's the party you want to go to.
Yeah, yeah.
But also, it's a party that if you're my age, you are never going to be going to.
Exactly, I don't want to go to that party, but I'm the age of their mother, so that's normal.
How do you know? It could be fun. I my slight worry is that it's a little bit refusal to grow up.
Yeah,
there's some arrested development in there, isn't there?
It's a little bit like, actually, we want to be young, we want to party, we want to have fun. It's a little bit pretty.
But that fashion is always like, do you remember, even Prada, like what I'm so bad with seasons, but like when they did the, it looked like a Miu Miu collection, all the bubble gums and the baby, that was exactly the same thing. It was like, why would grown women want to dress like children? But they do, you know, there is a. It's that prettiness, and I think it's interesting.
It's nice to see pretty when, you know, the thing I was saying right at the beginning of the conversation, how a lot of 20-year-olds in social media are all about Kardashian-type styling. Yeah. How can we look hot?
Yeah.
So I find that this prettiness incredibly refreshing because I'm fed up with a relentless barrage of women in their 20s wanting to be hot.
Yeah.
So this, I think, is wonderful.
But I also
just the word made me shiver.
Do you think there's this is something that other very successful designers have always had an interest in. Like, if you look at Comme des Garçons, Ray Kawakubo has always looked at these quite childish shapes, you know, Peter Pan collars or very oversized little dresses that kind of, you know, that it is like a childlike kind of
but
purity.
They're not girly. They can
I think Comme des Garçons is quite girly.
I think they can take a lot of.
I think the difference, though, here is that Comme des Garçons actually any body can wear any age.
Yeah.
A girl in 15 years and 90.
Yeah.
And 40, anybody. Actually, it doesn't have age bracket at all.
That's the thing though, when you wear it as an older person, a grown up say, you have to have a very specific way of wearing it without coming across too trying to be twee or young or
too
or girlish. Yeah. Exactly. It's like, I think these clothes are for young people.
Period.
But then how can they
there's
afford
no way.
It?
Exactly. So that was my next thing. Yeah. These people do not care about their target.
I don't think that about Molly, actually. If you
it's quite expensive.
I don't think Molly is just for young people. I agree with you, fashionista. I was like, who? Beyond, like, you know, everyone was going crazy for the Mimi Wade collection. I'm like, yeah, cool, it was cute, whatever. But like, no one above the age of like 29 is going to look. Like, I feel too old for that. Like, but I think Molly, if you, I was actually looking at the line sheet today, just looking at all the different stuff, and I do think that's it's quite common.
I think it's
in that
actually
sense.
She's
like, I can imagine.
She's making it more. I think she's, you know, she's deepening her collection. She's growing as a designer, and I think it's getting there.
Yeah.
But
it's
think that.
I mean, these looks here, they are.
Like that dress.
The grey dress.
The gingham dress. Like, that's gorgeous and would look great on.
Pretty much everything.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. But I agree with you, there is this big problem with like, who can afford your clothes, if you're making clothes.
Yeah, if you're making clothes for young people, I think they need to be realistic.
Yeah. Yes, which is why Marcus Almeida are so clever, and which is why, and their show this season was incredible.
Great example.
They've always kept their, you know, they're so
very
aware
clever.
That it's
great example,
young.
Yeah.
Girls, and they've kept their price
what's
point.
That, their classic denim jacket's what, £350?
Yeah.
You can so save up for that.
Yeah, like you can get a denim t-shirt for like, you know, £200 or something. Especially if you're clever, you're shopping the sale, you know, what have you. Like, but you're not going to be like, fuck, I can't afford any.
Yeah.
You know, and
because no one in their right mind should be spending £800 on a t-shirt.
No.
Really.
No. And I thought this was an amazing show. That's, and the way they cast all these like cool
I love them.
Girls from around. And,
the invites were very cool as well.
Yeah.
The invites, they just took photos of their friends from Instagram.
Yeah.
Actually, they had nothing to do with the brand.
Yeah.
And they just sent
it's all about
Masha
state of mind, isn't it?
Yeah.
Tess, like, I got to invite with
also,
a friend of mine.
Yeah.
Also, I think they're not trying too hard.
No.
It's just what it is, and that's what I like, you know, there is a certain honesty about that, whereas not in all of those, we're cool and young, you know, sometimes it's too much we're cool and young.
Yeah.
It's like,
well, they're not club
we're
kids
working
as well.
Yeah.
I think that's the difference, is there is this return to kind of, you know, Matty Bowman, who showed at Fashionista, he's like this cool kid, he's shot everywhere, and that has its place, but it's kind of the designer is enfant terrible, and they're just not like that. They're very, they're quite, not reclusive, but like they're not in the scene, you don't see them out and about, you know, they do what they do and they have their friendship, and it's kind of,
they're great,
you know, their friendship circle and what have you. And I think, yeah, it's interesting that.
And actually, the imagery is also very interesting.
Yeah.
Because they just collaborate with different photographers. Sometimes they just find a person who is like a muse.
Yeah.
Who's nothing to do with fashion. Mm. They just say, oh,
yeah.
Sometimes I get emails like, oh, this is.
I love their email. If you're on their mailing list for their e-commerce, it's so cute. They send you, like, it's, sometimes it's actually too cute. Like, if you're having a bad day, and they're like, hello, and you're like, no way. But it's really nice. It feels like real people. And I actually think that probably massively speaks to a. Because it's also, I do think, like, for a younger audience, when you shop, like, especially if you're shopping online, you don't want it to feel too different to how you speak to your friends or whatever. And it's got that casualness of like social media communication. It probably actually feels much more modern than the more formal e-commerce platforms, you know, which is much more like lofty and removed. Mm. It's very like a little gang.
And actually, I think slowly they're creating these tables that you can say, Marquis Almeida. If you think of particular jeans, distressed or coat, you see. And actually, now it's a check shirt.
Yeah,
I've seen check shirts in other collections, and I thought, oh, a bit Marquis Almeida.
Yeah. And it's really trickling down. My sister produced a check shirt yesterday from Marks and Spencer's.
Oh, really? Like,
Marquis Almeida.
Looks quite familiar to me.
Yeah,
they set trends.
Mm. Yeah, they're very clever.
But also, they took their time to develop because they started very small. Mm. They just did jeans. Then
they started very denim.
But also, that's affordable. Yeah. So, like with someone like Matty, it's like, okay, so you've done this collection for Fashionista, but what are you actually going to sell? Maybe like some printed T-shirts. That's essentially what Fashionista
has always been. Thus, hasn't it?
Yeah, but Marcus and Maida started in Fashionista and they thought, hey, denim.
They went on.
And it worked. Yeah. And that's something that they, you know, mined for a few seasons to really make it.
I think it's really clever the way they haven't rested on their laurels with that frayed denim thing. They've taken it forward quite
But everyone else started doing it, so they kind of had to be like,
well, I also like the way, I think they got the models to style themselves for the show, which I think was quite a cute little touch.
Yeah.
But I do think back to your point about Fashionista, I think with like Matty Bowman, I do think you can understand what he's doing. It's kind of about making a splash and you want to get noticed. And then, you know.
But it's very Saint Martins.
I don't understand.
It's very, Saint Martins. It's almost like he's holding a banner.
Yeah. I just worry for him because you look at what happened to Miriam Kirchhoff, which is, because Matty Bowman is the toast of, like, you know, press in London. Mm. You know, so
because of his famous friends.
I think also people like him as a guy.
He's really nice. And
he's really
confident.
Nice. Yeah, and I think But I look at Medium Ketchup and I remember they were like, could not have got more supported press. They were everywhere, and it's just like they couldn't turn that into a business. And it's like it is so easy to go from being flavor of the month, the coolest thing.
Yeah,
but the
Medium Ketchup's clothes were so expensive.
Yeah.
But there was no entry level with Medium Kirchhoff. It was all or nothing.
Yeah.
And that's hard to build up a tribe of
but
people who want to
with
wear
Matty,
your clothes.
That's exactly what you were saying. It's like, right, okay, but how do you turn this into...
But his clothes aren't as complex as Medium Kirchhoff's, are they? I mean, Medium Kirchhoff, when you actually feel and look at the clothes, they're beautifully made.
Mm. Mm. Oh, yeah, beautifully made. And then they'd be like, you know, gold python. It's like, okay.
But I like when Matty's reflecting what's happening in the clubs in Dalston. And, you know, the way that the girls are wearing those fishnet tights that have got the massive holes in them against like glitter and sequins. I mean, that is what girls are wearing on nights out.
Which
and
clubs?
I like seeing that.
I think it's just one party, actually.
I like seeing that.
It's just Loverboy party. There's no... Yeah. People don't dress up in Dalston.
No, I think they. I think that they've just like house parties and stuff. They're all having lots more fun than we are. We need to
switch. Let's go and break in.
I know. We
you're sounding like Granny Lou in the corner.
I'm really lame. I need to like go out and have some fun. I do. But I think it's kind of that sentiment that we all have, which is like. I guess it comes back to concern in a way because London in some ways does feel like a conveyor belt of young designers, and you just hope they can all find a place.
Succeed.
Because that's the worst feeling, is when you're like, oh great, but what's the point? It's horrible seeing people just kind of casually drop off the schedule and then it's like to the annals of fashion history.
If you are J.W. Anderson, you don't drop out because you are seriously talented. So my thing is always
some of the most talented designers.
Yeah, sometimes what I was going to say. Yeah, but sometimes you can be very talented and disappear, which is very sad. But I also think that your attitude matters. And you know, there are people that are too flashy, and then it's nothing really, and there are others that are maybe too shy. I don't know how to explain, I mean, but if you're really, really, really talented, it will work.
I think it's just a lot of designers kind of like brought up with the idea that they have freedom, but actually clothes is just making clothes for people to buy. It's actually really simple.
Quite true. It's quite
so
true.
So somebody has to want to pay you some money.
Well, I suppose there's a tradition of British designers being plucked to go and then design for
a big house in
Paris, so maybe that's what a lot of them hope for. And again,
well, so look,
sorry to see you
on
the Brexit, but I'm sure that
Siobhan,
they're thinking about that and how they'd rather work in Europe now.
And me, the Queen. Just after.
So are we feeling optimistic after the season?
Yes.
Yes, you
and,
are. Good.
Yes, and
you mean commercially
talk
or
about,
style-wise?
My favorite one, which was Faustine Stainments.
Yeah,
me too.
I love this design so much.
Adored it.
There's something more to it than just girlishness, because it's so interesting the way she designs.
Yeah, her process is incredible.
Textures and
I agree.
And I have to say, it was
so
the most beautiful presentation.
Yeah, amazing.
It was
I couldn't agree more. I was trying to talk about
it
her.
It was just like you entering in some weird movie, like I don't know, I love this moment that you think, oh, things are not the same anymore. This is what you want from fashion. Like,
it was quiet and calm.
I feel like give her a couple of years, she'll pop up in Paris somewhere, won't she?
Yeah,
she's French.
I mean at one of the big houses.
I think
she'll be plucked somewhere.
I think the thing is, actually, in London there's been a switch towards presentations and encouragement of presentations for the younger designers, and I think that's something that I think has been much overdue, because it gives you time to think about, to look at these clothes and see them. They don't have to concentrate on creating a 20 strong look collection. They can create 7 looks, which then they could actually put all into production if they want to.
And also they can shoot their lookbook at the same time.
Exactly.
And just commercially, it makes so much more sense.
And there's so much chance to get feedback, interaction, see how people... And it's, I think...
And they don't need to use models, maybe, because, for example, MM6 Magella, they did presentation all in mannequins.
Mannequins.
And it was really cool. Okay, they were really nice mannequins,
but
they didn't have to pay each model, and then they did a really interesting thing.
The problem with presentation sometimes is that you don't get the girls that you want, because they don't want to be taken for like 3 hours, or some agency,
they
don't even
think they're going to be... cares about the girls.
They do. They choose their girls.
No, I mean in terms of press, I think that idea of like we need to have big...
No,
it's a bit lame.
But it's not about big, it's not even some unknown girls, they just don't want to do presentations. But then every young designer, especially, they have a type.
They want to
cast in a certain way. And sometimes it's more difficult.
But I love a presentation.
Me too.
I love being able to look at the hem and see how the clothes are made. It's great.
And you can actually look
and you can frame a shot of a model. She's not moving, so it's not going to be blurry, and you know that you're going to actually get a really strong picture out of it rather than just, this is, someone flying past me.
And if you're really busy, you don't have to go and do a resee.
Yeah, exactly. No, I think it is good. And also, it goes back to what we were talking about right at the start, which is how young designers survive in this climate of big business, see now, buy now, speed, speed, speed. But I do in these presentations, they are distinguishing themselves as, like, kind of artists and makers, and it feels a bit slower, and it feels less like they're trying to kind of keep up on this rap race. It's saying, look, I'm special, my work is better, and I think that's nice as well.
I think it's more considered. Money a runway show costs.
Oh my god,
nobody wants to see a young designer in their second season forking out 20-30 grand for that.
You know, presentations sometimes are very expensive.
You get 3 hours, you get an impact that
exactly.
brings more value for money.
And also sometimes it's hard to fill a room for a fashion show. In presentation, it's more.
And we can all pop in.
You can have people popping in and out constantly.
It's a stream.
Also very beautiful.
It's less monolithic, I think.
I agree.
I love what Phoebe English does.
Oh my god, it's so good. I loved it so much.
She's great.
She's also developed quite a lot since the beginning.
It's
and also with the presentation, you can set your. It's not just clothes, you can create what you're
a little world and a story.
Completely.
Yeah.
It's narrative that always.
Narrative.
I love going to a good presentation
where
you get that story.
So that's our top tip to young designers if they're watching this presentation.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. We all agree.
Well, from going right back to our early conversation, if you want the influencers who may be the most influential people of all, they love a presentation because, as Rex said, they can photograph it.
And it's an interesting thing about the distribution of that, actually, because I guess the main.
shows are on all the big websites, but the presentations aren't necessarily, are they? And so I'm thinking again about Cleo Pepiat and how she is quite clever about distributing on social media, and actually she just relies on Instagram and everyone who goes to the shows to spread the word as well. That's quite an interesting distribution model as well.
Definitely the Instagram thing works better at presentation, 100%.
And you can go whenever, you can turn up whenever you like.
Exactly.
I'm fed up, Rebecca said, of looking at my camera and, you know, 30 pictures of totally unusable.
And I'm very good at focusing on the other side of the catwalk.
I've got lots of pictures of the front row. They all look great.
Yeah. But it's this thing where you see everyone get out their phone and just like a sheep take a picture of the first look and then like tweet it. And you're just like,
bah.
And the finale.
Maybe somebody can do a show and they ban the phones.
And nobody claps.
Hibaya did that at a men's thing. Hibaya about... Was it last season? It might have been last season. If you went in with your phone, they put a sticker on your phone so you can take pictures.
It's a bit self-defeating, though, wasn't it?
I think they had a reason for doing it. Something like they were previewing something or something. Clearly it didn't stick in the mind. But it was very good. Actually, I love what Shane Warren and Hibaya does. But I think they were showing a collection. They just wanted to preview it to people that were only going to be at the men's shows or something. But yeah, it doesn't work, that Stop the Tide thing, too much. But then these little... I do like these ideas, these little pop-up shows and moments that happen in unexpected locations. Mm. And
as long as they're not in too unexpected a location and you're like, crap, I've got to get to the show and my presentation's over there somewhere.
Yeah. But then I'd like to see people doing more stuff like this, like off schedule, you know, and like, I don't mean off schedule in terms of during Fashion Week, I mean like, you know, like everyone's so chock-a-block for time and then it's like, do something, you know, a random week at a random time that's all interesting.
Do a liar and set your own schedule.
Yeah, but then you don't have anybody from abroad.
And no bias.
Yes. That's the problem, no bias.
Well,
then you have to do your research and invite everybody.
Yeah.
And you have to employ a good PR person.
Yeah, but they didn't do it on a random weekend. They did it during a fashion week, which wasn't the right one for that collection.
Well, but also, I guess you just have a good sales agency who you know are going to be doing appointments and they're going to take your stuff to show to other people and have a good way of distributing amazing images.
Most buyers don't go to the shows, like loads of buyers don't go to the shows, they just go to the showrooms anyway.
Because you know who's I think it's Katie Rose at the Bridge Company. She was my assistant, so I'm very proud of her. But she's amazing because she looks after and the Bridge is specifically designed to support very young designers and teach them how to work fiscally as well as creatively.
Yeah.
And they have a showroom in Paris now for all their very young British labels. And I think that's fantastic because it stops people having to worry about coming
somewhere.
Well, yeah, but main market happens during Fashion Week. So
that's why it's brilliant.
That's when people are in town because...
Yeah.
Otherwise, you have to be there all year round, unless you have your own.
But I think we're gonna move away from a traditional Fashion Week type schedule. I think if you have a good enough brand, people come to you, and it doesn't matter where you show. Like, you know, it'll be bought, and people want it. I do think that's the case, and I think brands are starting to realise that they're looking at things like Gosha, but also things like, you know, Supreme and Palace and brands that have just become these huge things that have never kind of clamoured for attention. And I think you're going to see more people operating.
Yeah, and even like startups just selling directly through Instagram.
Yeah.
I think every brand want a Supreme recipe of success.
Oh my God, definitely.
Because I think any brand out there, they would be probably pay any money.
Yeah.
But it's not a formula, it's just, you know.
You know what? I had this conversation with this really cool kid in Paris about Supreme. And all it is a good product, limited edition, collaborations with
interesting people.
But it's finding those interesting people and being tapped into the market that your customer is into.
And not making a lot of stuff.
Making
a few
things. And not
having a scarcity, of course. Right. Yeah.
Because that's what, to feel like it's worth spending money on, something has to feel cool. And if it's just being pushed on you, I think actually you are like, oh, well, you can't be that great if you're having to like...
Pump it out.
Yeah. Pump it out. And I think that's the thing, isn't it? It's that. But there's no formula, as you say. Anyway, I'm really conscious of time. I've been going on for ages. So shall we give all the London designers an amazing round of applause for giving us so much to talk about?